Gracious Father, as we come before you, we are truly humbled by what you have shown us. You have shown us your desire to touch our hearts and our souls, to open our hearts and our minds to understand, and to shower upon us not only your remarkable promise of hope and life, but your own blood so that we can be cleansed. We have gathered here to ask you to bless us, to reiterate and to strengthen our understanding, and to touch us once again through the blessing of your Son. And so we place this time into your hand. We rejoice together at all that you will do. And we thank you now for the blessings that you will bestow, as we pray this in Jesus' name.
Truly,
you should confess. For the Holy Scripture declares, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Do you heartily repent of all your sins committed in thought, word, and deed? Then declare so by saying,
I do repent.
Truly, you should repent. As did the penitent sinners, King David, who prayed for a contrite heart, Peter, who wept bitterly, prodigal son, and others. Do you sincerely believe that God, by grace for Jesus' sake, will forgive you all your sins? Then declare so by saying,
I do believe.
Truly, you should so believe. For Holy Scripture declares, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Do you promise that with the aid of the Holy Spirit, you will henceforth amend your sinful life? Then declare so by saying,
I do promise.
Truly, you should so promise. For Christ the Lord says, let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. Finally, do you believe that through me, a called servant of God, you will receive the forgiveness of all of your sins? Then declare so by saying,
I do believe.
As you believe, even so may it be to you. Upon this, your confession. I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in his stead, and by his command. I do forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The psalm for this evening is Psalm 51, and we do read this responsibly. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions.
Wash away all my iniquities and cleanse me from my sin.
For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me.
Against you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are right when you speak and justified when you judge.
Surely, I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived
me. Surely, you desire truth in the end of hearts. You teach me wisdom in the inmost place.
Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow.
Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice.
Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities.
Create in me a pure heart, God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me.
Do not cast me from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me.
Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will turn back to you.
Save me from blood guiltiness, O God. God who saves me, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness.
O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise.
You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings.
The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit.
A broken, contrite heart, God, you will not despise.
Glory
be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
You may proceed. Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this, whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we judged ourselves rightly, we would not come under judgment. Would you please rise to the reading of the Holy Gospel? The Holy Gospel is found in the 14th chapter of Mark. It begins with verse 12. When the Lord gathered with his disciples, there was seed being planted to have a transformation of their understanding, of both their mind and their heart and their soul. Everything that the Lord did, everything that he did, was to give them an insight of what exactly he was doing, which was showing them a one-way promise from the Father in heaven to them by grace. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when it was customary to sacrifice the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples asked him, where do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover? So he sent two of his disciples, telling them, go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. Say to the owner of the house, he enters, the teacher asks, where is my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large upper room, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there. The disciples left and went into the city and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. When evening came, Jesus arrived with the 12. While they were reclining at the table, eating, he said, I tell you the truth. One of you will betray me. One was eating with me. They were sad. One by one, they said to him, surely not I. It is one of the 12, he replied, one who dips bread into the bowl with me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. And woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body. Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, and they all drank from it. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. He said to them, I tell you the truth. I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God. And they had sung again. They went out and on the bottles. Here is the Holy Gospel. What is the sacrament of Holy Communion?
It is the true body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, under the bread and wine, instituted by Christ himself for us Christians to eat and to drink.
Where is this written?
The holy evangelists Matthew, Mark, Luke, and the apostle Paul tell us, the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to them,
On Maundy Thursday, our Lord set up a premise for his church, for us individually. He demonstrated the unity of the scriptures. The Passover was set up by the Father so that the people of Israel would understand one vitally important principle of their faith. They were forgiven by the blood of the Lamb that had been substituted for the blood of man, based upon a promise that pointed to the one sacrificial Lamb, whose one last sacrifice would cover the sins of all people. The Passover celebration was a 3.5-hour meal. There were many aspects to it that pointed to how the grace of God had worked, how it continued to work, but more importantly, what it pointed to, which was what the Messiah would accomplish on behalf of his people. So when Jesus took his disciples, they celebrated the Passover celebration because he had explained to them that Elijah had come in the form of John the Baptist, meaning his teaching. And so the time was now done. The passing, it was complete. Then he did what no one else could do. He offered the Lord's Supper. He gave them a new promise, a new covenant, with a new form, a new fashion. Simpler, easier, much more direct. But what he promised was what the Messiah alone promised. That in the supper, they would receive four things. They would receive bread, which was his body. Wine, which was his blood. It wasn't a representation. It was a gift from the throne of God upon we who were sinners, so that we would be personally touched by the one whose blood was paid. He set up this holiness upon this meal. This is a reference to that meal. It is explaining to us a portion of what takes place in the Lord's Supper. At the very top, this little section right here. This is where we're starting. There is an anchor. It's the first thing that is attached to this. There is an anchor. Because it's declaring what binds us to the Father, what binds us to heaven, what binds us to forgiveness, what binds us to everything is the Lord. Right underneath it is a chalice. And right in the chalice, because it makes the assumption, you know that the chalice holds the wine, there is a little round thing. You can't see it even on this picture well, but you can when you climb a 12-foot ladder and you steer right at it. There is a wafer. We have the Lord's Supper being proclaimed to us as part of the anchor the Lord uses to bind us to Him. It is a calling, a proclamation, knocking on the door in our presence. We are invited to the supper. It is not our right. It is not our supper. It is the Lord's supper. It isn't our altar. It isn't our church. It is the Lord's. Everything about the supper takes away anything that has to do with it. We have an involvement in holding it before us as the gift of grace from the Father in heaven through his Son who died in order to give it to us. It is holding before us the sanctity of what our God has done, which, by the way, is what is being proclaimed right here. On each side, these are representation of candles. There are two of them. It is to point us to a fact and truth about our Lord. He was God and man. So on the very top, when we have all of this being done, all is being proclaimed as, it is the Lord, it's the Lord, it's the Lord, and it's the Lord, and he has a unique position. He is God and man, and he is the Messiah. Now, if you notice, right below it, or right beside it, I should say, there are three red sections. It is proclaiming what the triune God's choice was in order to bring to us forgiveness. It was the blood of his Son. It was the sacrificial lamb that was given on our behalf that points us back to the Lord's Supper, which points us back to who is our anchor. Now, the next portion is just overwhelming to me, how this window has set this up. And there are so many things going on, I don't even know how to do it all. So, you'll just have to bear with me as I get too excited and then I go on. You will see. This doesn't do it well. This very, very top, the very top, that's blue. It doesn't come across that way because of the angle by which I had to take the picture. There are, on each side, come down, there are seven. When you count the top, there are seven blue spots that points to heaven. The unity of heaven and earth through the triune God, who has united himself to this world, and he's done it through our Lord. On this side, we have the same thing. On the bottom, it is set up so that then when we look at just the bottom, there are three across the bottom. That points us to the triune God who has granted to us heaven. Now, when you look at this section right here, and right here, right here, and right here, each of these sections have 10 spaces in them. Each of these things have 10 spaces in them, because each one's pointing us to perfection by which God chose to bring his salvation into the world. And that salvation is Christ. And he always uses the number 10 to represent that. Perfection or completeness. Salvation is done. Now, we have this little section right here. Overwhelms you more than anything else. We have four. 1, 2, 3, 4 on this side. 1, 2, 3, 4 on this side. It's a total of 8. It points us to the fact that we are now on the 8th day, the day of the resurrection. It's called the 8th day of creation, the new creation. And it is put together so that there is 4 on this side and 4 on this side. So when we combine them together, it's the number 8. It's throughout this remarkable window that it keeps on saying this amazing statement about what it is to be a New Testament believer. Then we have these three little divified things here. This has 10, this has 8, this has 4. We have the perfection coming to the world through Christ. We have him rising on the 8th day, the day of the resurrection Sunday, and we have 4 showing what he unified heaven with earth. All in the little bitty duplifies right there. Then we have on each side just 2. 2 of the little points down here, which point us to the fact that he is God and man. And when you put them all together, he unifies heaven and earth because it's talking about earth being bound to our Lord. We have 3 sections. Each of them have the same thing. On each side, it's the same. Have I lost you yet? Have I lost you? Because I will go on until you get it, because you can't miss it. This is the most amazing stuff. I get so excited, I can't even tell you. Now, I want to show you the wisdom. Now, on this side of Christ, here in my seat, there's this little box that has 6 holes in it. See that? This is a revelation that God made in the scripture about when he wants to show something is overwhelmingly real, he repeats it 3 times. How many holes we have? How many holes? Yeah, 3 sets of 2. 2 is always a reference to the Christ being both God and man. You repeat it 3 times, it means it's the greatest, it's the only one who can ever be. So this little thing right here is right next to his head. It's proclaiming, he is the Messiah, he is the Messiah, and he is the Messiah. When you repeat it 3 times, it means he's the only Messiah, and will always be the only Messiah. It is an overwhelming settlement that whoever did this window, brilliant, just brilliant. Then we look at his halo, and he has the 3 red again, showing that the blood of Christ alone, brought salvation to the world, and his holiness is given to us. And when you look at this little halo, there is 4 boxes, and then there are 6 boxes. Four boxes on this one, six boxes on this one. It points again to the reality of what our Lord is doing. You know why heaven and earth is? Because he was God and man. Everything is being proclaimed so that you and I cannot miss the fact that when we come to the Lord's Supper, we are in the presence of God. This is not a joke. It's not something we just say. We are actually in the presence of God. It's the purpose of the window. When we look upon it, we cannot help but understand that when we come into his presence in the Lord's Supper, it is the Lord that we are facing. On the side of this, we have these two little blue things right here. Heaven comes to us because he was both God and man. He is standing on three rocks at the bottom. This was not by chance. It was to show us he was the triune God. The Father, Son, and Spirit dwelt bodily in Christ. Then we have these four little things over here that represents the fact that what he redeemed was the world. He has this green on to show us where life comes from. The red is showing how it was brought to us. He is life. The red is on the outside. It's to proclaim to us how he brought this life to us. And how he brought it to us was through his death on the cross and shed his blood. We have these. This bottom portion is remarkable. Because first of all, if you will see, there are six big things in the middle. That's again a reference to him and back to him being man of God, man of God, man of God. To give him the highest praise it can possibly be. On this side, we have this cross that is bolder, clearer than on the other side. This one has red that stems out from all four sections. Because this is called the gift that we know of Christ being the one who has redeemed the whole world. The one on the other side, there's only blood under the two. There's only this red portion under the two. The cross is beat up. And if you look real closely, you see what is coming up from the ground through it. It's the spear. This is showing the ugliness of the cross, but yet what it still gave us, which was salvation through his blood. Now, if you count across the bottom, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 boxes on each side. 11, 12 boxes on each side. This is to show us what he has unified. Old Testament, New Testament, bound in Christ alone, unified so that we understand and that we cannot miss it. Just love what he's done. We have three over here because this is a reference to heaven. And again, it points us to the reality that this is the triune God. We have this little thing called a staff. The staff is gold. Gold is always a reference to the holiness and remarkable presence of God and his grace in the life of his people. The staff is also a sign, if you've ever messed with sheep, the dumbest creature is God ever created. The staff has this little hook on the end so that they can grab him around the neck and pull him up because they're too stupid and no one can see. And he grabs him and he moves him forward and he moves him all around. This is a reference to the fact that God has to pull us to him. We don't pull him to us. This knock on the door, when you see this little knock that our Lord's doing, with a backhand, he has an open hand. This isn't a banging on the door, it's an invitation. As I have said before, and I firmly believe, I have never, and I've been to most all of your houses, one form or the other, and I have seen you sometimes, it's been a whole evening, I've not seen any of you all inadvertently get up and go to the front door and open it up to see if someone's in. You know what we answer the door? Now, if someone comes up and goes, we don't like to go answer the door, it is an invitation. It's his invitation. He who hears, it says, and then opens the door. Well, the reason they open the door is because the word of God has touched their heart and transformed their mind. And all the credit gives goes back to the one who is knocking. It's never the individual who opens the door. It because we don't just randomly open the front door and look to see who's there, because there's nobody there. So the Lord invites us. There are 7 boxes on this site that make up the story. Because what is proclaiming, this is only one way for any of us to be unified with heaven. That's through our Lord. Through his invitation, his blood, and his life. Every single dent that's on this has a direct reference to the wonder of what our God has done. That's why when I look at this, we have 4 and 8 and 10 and 12 and 4 and 8 and 2. Everything is repeated over and over at 6, and everything is reinforcing the simple truths of what happened at the Lord's Supper. God instituted a meal that is not logical. It is divine. Only Christ himself, who was God and man, could give us a meal that was physical and spiritual at the same time and bind them together so that when we receive the bread and we receive the wine, we receive his body and blood. And I'm telling you, we receive his body and blood because of what he has accomplished on the cross. And that's why when you look at just the simplicity of how the two crosses are made, you see the remarkable nature, the two natures of our Lord. The man who died, suffered, and had a spear ran in his side, and God who granted his mercy and grace to us all. So when you look at this picture, there's one last thing I need to say, and then we're going to be done. This is the latch. It's gray. If I see this, see? If you look really closely, you can see the lifting mechanism. This little thing right here. Everybody see it? Okay, everybody see it? This is really important. It's proclaiming the door cannot be opened without invitation. The door cannot be opened without invitation. Everything with God is he invites us to do. The burden of changing our heart falls on him. The burden of coming up with a means by which we will be touched by his grace falls on him. Everything is by grace. And the latch is gray. It means we have no ability to do anything on our own. Nothing was done by accident. Whoever put this together had 1,000 messages, because the purpose of every stained glass window is to proclaim the gospel in pictures. And so they filled it with overwhelming imagery. You can look at this 1,000 times and you're going to find things you didn't see before. The numbers are overwhelming how they are repeated over and over and over again. Nothing that we can say. This cannot be by chance, because it is too remarkable how consistent it was. The beauty of what our Lord has proclaimed in this always overwhelming. Last thing. Very last thing. On this side, you'll see these two little quirks. Does anybody see it? It's supposed to represent hyssop. It's supposed to represent hyssop. Hyssop is a bundle that was on a little pole, and they dipped it inside the blood and used it. This is to show on the screen, because it's to demonstrate where life comes from. The Old Testament Passover and extended to us as a sign.
Ms. Whitman. It is to humble you there, because it reinforces everything the Lord teaches us about His Son, especially that He invites us. So it takes all pride away, all arrogance away, all concepts of thinking we have a right to receive His Son. We don't. We deserve to be damned. He invites us to His Supper so that the very nature that we understand we have, which is sin, can be cleansed. May God help us to always grow in our understanding, hold before Him the wonder of what He has done.
For Gavin, we thank you for the success of his surgery.
and ask now your healing power upon him, that you'll give him patience, and that you'll grant him your continued blessing. And for Rick and Mary, and for Eric and Allison, we thank you for the remarkable gift of life today. May you hold them all close to you, dear Lord. May your light and strength be upon them. And may they always be reminded of the wondrous gift of life that you have granted, and the life that you will grant will last forever. So we place it into your hands this night with the confidence that you provide us. And as your people, dear Lord, we're truly privileged to love you, and we do this night once again in the prayer that your Son has taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after the same manner also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This is the New Testament in my blood, which has been shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. May the peace of our Lord be with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through your supper. And we ask you, Lord, that in your mercy, you would strengthen us in faith towards you and in sincere and caring love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end.
Everybody's going to see this. So it's not right?
Yeah.